I'm Philip Glass, and I'm a composer. I began playing when I was six, and I was actually practicing and playing seriously by the time I was eight. By the time I was 15, I began to get very curious about music. My question was, which no one could give me a proper answer for, was where does music come from? So I got the idea that if I wrote music, I would find out where it came from. That turned out not to be true. I never did find out. At a certain point, I discovered I had developed a voice, a certain language. That's a concern for a lot of young composers. We're all concerned about when are we going to find that voice. It seems to be such an important thing. In fact, I've spoken to many young people about this. For sure you get the voice by the time you're 30, about. Some people get it much earlier. Schubert, Mendelssohn, I mean, there are people like that. But most of us, it takes a little while. That's actually not the real issue. The real issue is not when do you get your voice, but the real question is how to get rid of it. It's only when you start to get to that point that the real discovery and journey for the composer really begins. At a certain point, I became a performer also. That really became an issue when I had finished my actually studies, which was I finished late. I finished when I was 28. I finished very late. And I had to decide what I was going to do with the skills that I had. And I had already decided I wasn't going to be a teacher. I didn't feel that I was qualified to do that. I didn't have the aptitude for it. So I became a performer. For me, it was the way I could get the music played. When I began to write music, that was, let's say, very radically different from the music that I had studied and from the music that was around me. I had trouble finding people to play the music. So I formed an ensemble, this ensemble that I'm playing with now. From the beginning, I had an audience that wasn't very big. I remember my very first concert, there were only six people in the audience, and one was my mother. I counted her, she was one. My first concert hall was 1974, and I rented it myself, but I sold it out. The next one, I did have to rent this one. The next one was at Metropolitan Opera House. And that was huge. There were 3,500 people there. And we did it twice. So we think of it that way, that in scarcely seven, maybe 8 or 9 years, the audience had gone from six to 3,500. So you say, well, how did that happen? I began to believe after a time that the kind of music I was writing, which had seemed so radical at the beginning, there must have been an urgent need for a big change to happen. And I wasn't the only one. There was a generation of people who were pushing in this direction. In different ways sometimes, but the idea was to the accepted idea of modern music, we had actually simply changed the whole definition of it. At the beginning, people didn't think I knew anything. They thought I was a complete idiot. And I didn't know how, I would never know what a symphony was. But in fact, I had been through the Juilliard School in New York, and I had studied with Nadia Boulanger. I had impeccable training, credentials. I didn't show them off in any way because I wasn't teaching anywhere. After Einstein on the Beach, which was for the ensemble, people in the opera world asked me to write operas. And people in the symphonic world asked me to write symphonies. I wasn't actually inclined to do it at all. I expected to work with the ensemble kind of exclusively. I had no idea of moving into another area, but the first opera that after Einstein on the Beach was Satyagraha, that was commissioned by the Netherlands Opera. It was an opera house with singers and orchestra. And I had stopped writing orchestra music when I was, after I graduated. You graduated from Juilliard by writing an orchestra piece. But then after that, no one was going to play it anyway. I was not interested in writing music that no one was going to play. I didn't write it, didn't do it. with Satyagraha, I was starting to write with orchestras again. And then I've written quite a few operas since then, and I've had lots of experience writing with opera orchestras. And along the way, by the time I didn't write my first symphony until I was 51. I've made up for that. I've written 10 since then. By working with the theater, I began to work with image, movement, and text. Besides music, those are the four elements. Those elements make that up. And I became fairly good at it. I got to know how to do it. I began to understand it. I spent a lot of time in the theater. I would go watch lighting rehearsals. I would watch all kinds of things, costume fittings, anything. I really wanted to understand how the theater worked. So that was a kind of a parallel universe for me. There was these two universes came together with Einstein on the beach. From there, it was easy to move into the opera house because people wanted to hear what I would do. More directly, there was another thing that began happening that was most interesting. With Satyagraha, I began writing an opera that was concerned with social issues, with a social change through nonviolence. That's one thing. But there are many other things that, with Godfrey Reggio, who made films like Carina Scassi and Paolo Cassi, he was interested in the impact of technology on contemporary life. So I began to look at operas in terms of bringing into my active creative life questions of society. One of the questions that we as composers and artists often ask ourselves is what does it have to do with the world we're living in? Because if you're working in experimental music, which I was sometimes called that, it wasn't at all clear that anybody really cared what you did. One way of doing that was if you were involved with social issues, which I was, I discovered that as I became older, I was more and more concerned about how society worked and how society changed, how society treated its citizens. All these questions came up. I wasn't writing radical political music when I was young. I was just writing experimental music for my ensemble. By the time I got to my 40s and I began having children, that had made a big difference. I had a family, the children began thinking about the world they lived in. I became active in my country and things like the civil rights movement, the anti-war movements, these kinds of things began getting my attention. And I began bringing those subjects into the opera world. The first three operas, Einstein was about a scientist. Akhenaten, it was about a religious figure, actually. Satyagraha was about a political figure. So I was taking the three estates they're sometimes called, you know, science, politics, and religion. And each of those three were addressing the issue of social change. I wrote my first concerto for violin orchestra. I wrote it for my father, who had died actually 10 years before, 10 or 12 years before. When he was alive, I don't think I would have known how to write a real violin concerto. By the time I got the commission to write it, I decided to write it for him, and I decided to write a piece that he would have liked. Now, that meant it would have had to be a popular piece. He had a orchestra, he knew something about music, but he wasn't really interested in experimental music or the kind of political issues that I was interested in. Generally speaking, concertos are popular pieces, and they get done all the time, and people play them all the time. I've written about a dozen of them. I mean, all different kinds, double concertos for a violin and cello, for two pianos, I'm writing for two pianos right now, for a saxophone quartet, and then all the several piano concertos, another second violin concerto. I've written a lot of them. Actually, that comes about because a player asked me for a concerto. So I know exactly how to do it. I think of it as part of the literature of concerto, as something that's different. It's not like operas. It's not like symphonies. Concertos have a whole history and a dynamic and a relationship to the public, which is quite different. And I accepted that very readily. I was interested in writing popular pieces, so I did. One of the things that I learned very quickly was to let the music go. At the time when I was writing this music, no publishing company was interested. I am working with other publishers now, and I have a company within a company, so to speak. But at the time when I was writing pieces of Einstein and Beast, nobody wanted it. So I ended up owning everything. And then I decided I had a very simple rule in the company. If anybody wanted a piece of music, they had to ask for it. They had to have an agreement with me. The young companies, like the dance companies, if they were just a young company, I charged them $5 for every performance. But they didn't have to pay me until they got to $25, which they never did. So I never got that money, but I didn't care. But what I wanted to do was to establish a relationship with other artists. What I've noticed that's happened a lot in theater and in literature is that after a writer is gone, the estate comes in and they start making rules about who will do things. My rule is yes. That's my rule. You want to use it? Use it. I have a unique relationship with the body of work that I've done because I'm still performing. I often do concerts for music from as early as 1968. So I'm, on a recent concert, I might play music from 1968 to maybe the year 2002 or 3. So there can be almost 35 years. Appear a long period of time, so that by playing the old pieces, the early pieces, I'm discovering that their young audiences like the early pieces. They like the early pieces more than the later pieces, and I like to play them. So what that does for me is that I don't have to imagine how these pieces sound. I play them, and I play them in front of audiences, and I have the response from people. The transaction that happens between the performer and the composer and the audience is constantly alive to me. So I'm writing a new piece now for a double piano concerto, and I'm noticing that there are elements from quite a long time ago that are showing up in this piece. However, it's also changed. I'm writing kind of similar music, but I'm writing it differently, and it's actually becoming. I've gotten slower again because I've had to relearn how to write music using elements from the past but putting them into a different context. So I'm very actively involved in, let's say, in reinventing old pieces, finding language that can go into a different direction. The structural music that I wrote a long time ago, I don't write it anymore, but I play it all the time.